Did I read an 800-page book out of pure spite? Yes, yes, I did. (laughs) 2021 has definitely been a year. I have read over 700 books so far this year, but as we are approaching the year end, I decided to give myself one last reading challenge, which is to read an 800-page book within the last few days of the year, because I like to collect very pretty books that sometimes I have no intention of reading whatsoever. This is not a surprise to viewers who have been watching me for a very long time, and this is most definitely not a surprise to my friends who have always laughed at me spending so much money on high fantasy or just like genres of books that I don't read at all, but I just want to keep it on my shelf for the occasional time that I do want to gravitate something outside of the genres that I'm comfortable with. And because really, I do have a deep fear of FOMO. I really don't like missing out on really cool things. And one of the books that did blow up was this one from Sarah J. Maas called House of Earth and Blood, and it's book number one in Crescent City. Now, Crescent City book number two comes out next year, and when I saw the cover and I saw that it was an Indigo exclusive edition available here in Canadian bookstores, I decided to order myself a copy because it was only $25. I can definitely afford it, so why not just do it? But the funny part was that I really don't have any sense of urgency or need to read this book at all, because I've never read a Sarah J. Maas book before. But because of my fear of FOMO, I have already collected a lot of series from Sarah J. Maas. And my friend Lacey from Lacey Book Lovers actually is always criticizing me for buying books that I have no intention of reading. So out of pure spite, I decided to actually pick this book up and finish it within the last few days of the whole year. So I actually ended up picking up the audiobook for this book because there's no way that I can work a full-time job while reading an 800-page book. So I was actually listening to the audiobook as I was working, and I actually listened to it when I was out on my walks. And it was a very painful process because the audiobook was 29 hours long, and I ended up listening to it in one full sitting, and it was just so long. So many things happened in this book, because obviously this is the first book in a series. I don't even know how long it would be, but Sarah had to essentially establish the world, create these characters that we have to somewhat feel emotion for, and actually create a riveting plot line for us to keep continuing an 800-page book. When I was reading this book, I already was checking the reviews to see if this book was even interesting at all, and a lot of people already said that this book, you cannot give up on it. You have to read at least halfway through before you get to the good and juicy parts, to the parts that you actually end up caring about the book. And to be honest, it was within the first 100 pages that I was actually really interested in the book in the first place, because this book actually reads a lot like a contemporary indie romance, because our heroine is this really beautiful girl who loves to go out, who loves to drink, who loves to party. She's half human, half fae, and she has a bunch of friends that she spends a lot of time with, and she has a great friend group. One day, something actually really damaging happens, and she has to suffer a lot of grief, and she has to get over that. Because it was really fast-paced within the first 100 pages, I was actually really intrigued by our characters. But towards already like the quarter mark in, I can see why it is really slowing down and why people complained about the pacing and complained that nothing really happened, because Sarah was still establishing this world that I don't even really quite understand. I expected a really high fantasy setting, but really this book took place in a city that was very much like any other city that you have ever lived in. It's more urban fantasy than fantasy, because these people or these creatures or these animals, they have all the technology, all the transportation vehicles and things like that that we ourselves use in real life. Basically, this book also read like a mystery crime novel that your dad will probably read or your brother might read. It had a lot of mystery and crime elements to it, because obviously our heroine needs to figure out who the mass murderer is in the city. She also has to work with her bodyguard, who is just really another investigator. And they both go on these like really grand adventures throughout the whole city, meeting different characters that rule the different cities within like the world that Sarah has built in, and then they have to piece together the crime. Overall, this book was not enjoyable for me, mostly because I did not like mystery. Lisi was right in the sense that why am I buying books that don't interest me at all, especially since I don't like mystery and crime. Obviously, I bought it because of FOMO and how beautiful the cover is, and obviously inside the cover as well. I didn't enjoy it because I don't like mystery. I don't like crime. I didn't really care too much about it because Sarah really dragged out the whole story. I felt like this book could have at least been like 500 pages if she really wanted to write a lengthy novel, and I felt like 800 pages was definitely an overkill. The second book is already set to be around 800 pages too as well, and that's just crazy insane to me. Also, another comment is that this is supposed to be her debut adult novel, but to be honest, this one doesn't read like an adult novel. It reads more like a new adult novel with very little spice. I thought that we were going to get some heated scenes, but there really wasn't many. And our hero and heroine, they actually have a very slow burn romance, so it's not really insta-love. They both have a lot of stuff to get through in order to embark in a healthy relationship. So I really appreciated that, because our hero actually had a love of his life that he had to let go of, and then our heroine herself has a lot of issues in her life that she has to get through before she can even think of moving on to the next step with our hero. So I really like that too as well. But overall, I gave this book a 3 out of 5 stars, and if I didn't read this book out of pure spite, I probably would have never read this book at all, and I probably would have just kept it on my shelves just for the aesthetics of it. And yes, to answer your questions, book number 2 is still pre-ordered in my account, and I just want the blue cover to go next with the red cover. But for now, I'm actually quite happy that I did read Sarah J. Maas, because I understand why she is so popular in young adult, mostly because her fantasy is very easy to understand. The world building is very simplistic. The characters are very simplistic, and it's mostly written in a very easy, digestible manner that no young reader can not understand. I had no issue sinking into this book, and I'm sure that if I read Throne of Glass series, I'm gonna really enjoy it too. But this one, average read, gave it 3 out of 5 stars. But anyways, that is it for my review of House of Earth and Blood, Crescent City, book number 1. And I guess thank you to Lacey for pushing me to read an 800-page book in one day. I'll see you guys again next time in a new video. Bye.